Early Christian heterodoxies. Heterodox, again, meaning false teachings, different teachings.
Opposite of orthodoxy, which is true or right teaching.
We're going to look at Apollinarianism, Nestorianism, Monophysitism, which is also called Eutychianism. Notice here, whenever I have the solid line, it represents the view of Apollinarian being strong and prominent. The dotted line represents a continuation of people holding to that view, but not as prominent as it was before. The Council of Constantinople is the primary reason why you see it turn into a dotted line, because the Council of Constantinople condemned Apollinarianism, as we'll see in just a moment. Apollinarianism is basically this. Now listen, you gotta listen to these details. Christ was God, okay, no problem there, right? Christ was God who took on a human body without a human mind. Okay? You basically got the human body and you've got an insertion of the divine logos, the divine word of God, the second person of the Trinity is inserted in. The divine mind took the place of what would have been the human mind. The Word became flesh only in the sense that God took on a human body. And as I said before, some people have termed this God in a bod. That's what Christ was. Many times that's the way we think of Christ, as just simply the flesh walking around with the controls of God. You know, you got kind of like that show of the aliens came down and took over all the people, you know, and you opened up their chest and you see an alien kind of, and they're going, zzz, you know, and you see the real thing deep down inside, but the other was just what looked like the real thing. And sometimes we think of Christ and we say, well, the real thing is God, you know, and they're controlling things. That this humanity, this flesh is not the real thing. It's kind of the way Apollinarius and Apollinarianism believed. Apollinarius of Laodicea is a friend of Athanasius, teacher of Jerome, condemned the Council of Constantinople, and also at Chalcedon it was condemned again, so it was doubly bad.
Just before we go in, well, it's fine. Just a simple question, though. Understanding just where we started, does the Bible teach this? Does the Bible teach, in other words, is this position arrived at from reading the Bible? Okay, so you bring up a good question, and that's that obviously something happens at his baptism where the Spirit comes down and the Father says, this is my Son in whom I'm well pleased. So there may be a question of division there, whether he takes on godness at baptism.
But that would be an issue of adoptionalism, which Apollinarius was not an adoptionalist. He did not believe that he was from the very beginning.
From the very beginning.
From conception. Well, the canon, at least, I mean, for the first century or so, you had the Gospels, Acts, and all the Pauline corpus accepted, and there was no problem with that. So those were in circulation very early. A few of the books of the canon were in dispute here and there, but for the most part, these people would have access to most of the canon of Scripture that would be relevant in these issues, especially the Pauline corpus. Here's basically what he did, was he took the divine logos, insert it, and the best way to think of it is human body, divine spirit. No human mind. Gregory of Nazianzus says he assumes that man, speaking of Apollinarius, speaking against him, he assumes that man who came down from heaven is without a mind. Not that the Godhead of the only begotten fulfills the function of the mind and is the third part of his human composite in as much as soul and body are in it on its human side, but not the mind, the place of which is taken by the Word of God. So if you can just think of it as people believing that he did not have a spirit or a soul. Well, tell me what's wrong with this? Denies his full humanity. Whenever you're reading about Christ and you are reading what he is doing, are you thinking of him in terms of his divinity or in terms of his humanity?
Depends on what he's doing.
You're exactly right. It depends upon what he's doing. If he's hungry, than we think of as humanity. But for the most part, what do? Both? Okay.
Let's say he's talking to the Pharisees and they're questioning him about something, but he knows what's in their hearts, as the text often reads. Yeah.
What if he's walking on water? Think primarily of his cognition, though, because this is what we're trying to deal with, the human mind. The way he's thinking, his ability, his self-recognition of deity and the cognition that comes with deity. Do you think he knew everything while he was here on the earth? Do you think whenever he thought, and he might look at somebody, and he could see right into their heart something that a normal human couldn't do, and he could will that at any time? Do you think that he did sometimes see into people's hearts in such a way? Do you think whenever he was on the way to Samaria at the woman in the well, before he saw her, he knew exactly where she was at?
Yes, because he said, "I must need food."
Do you think that he knew what was going on with people around the other side of the world at the same time whenever he was here in his cognition? But what did he ask? What was the question that he asked of the woman who touched his garment? He said, "Who touched me?" So it's interesting because he says, "I felt the power leave me." But at the same time, was he being serious? Did he not know who touched him?
I think he knew who touched him, but he wanted to...
Why did he know who touched him? How could he have? He didn't see him. Because he's God. Because he's working with his God cognition. And so what you're expressing is Apollinarianism.
And yet, what do the disciples say in that same example? They turn to him and say, how can you ask who touched you? Look, at the people are all around you. They're crowding you. And Jesus says, no, who touched me? I felt the power go up from me. Absolutely. There's certainly, he does it with intention, the intention to draw her out. And obviously it ends up being recorded in scripture. Number two, she is healed. And she is healed, interestingly enough, by touching him. And yet he's drawing that out for a very specific purpose.
I wanted to assume, though, right now at this point, remember, we're stepping off our ladders. Let's not assume anything. Let's just deal with it as we go through this and say, okay, why would the early church condemn this type of thinking? Why would they condemn you thinking with a God mind, not with a human mind?
He wasn't Christ.
That's right. That's what the issue comes down to. If he wasn't fully man, what good is the redemption? Now let's take that one step further, okay? Here's the way that the early church thought, and we'll learn this in soteriology. They thought in terms of redemption. Whenever somebody would ask, how did Christ redeem you? What do you say? What do you say today?
He died for our
sins. Does anybody know what the early church would have said whenever they say, how does Christ redeem you?
Took my place.
Okay. Took my place where, though?
On the cross.
No.
Yeah.
Not only that.
Where is our place, or where do we belong right now without Christ's redemption? Yeah, ultimately, that'll be our ultimate place. In other words, if we're not serving Christ as king, who are we serving? We would say ourselves, but Satan.
They would say something in this sense, that he took our place not only in death, but in life. He had to come and they called it recapitulation view of the atonement. He had to recapitulate our life in every step. He had to be like us and live our life without sin. And so they saw a major redemptive factor in the fact that Christ lived his life on a daily basis, struggling the same way we struggle, and yet ended up without sin. They would say that's a huge component to our redemption. He recapitulated what man is so that he could redeem man. Not only the death on the cross, but the life that he lived was part of the redemption. Now, how is it that if he was just thinking with the God mind, he cannot represent me on a daily basis? You and I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. If he knew what was going to happen tomorrow and the next day and the next day and every detail of every day, if I knew that, I could get through life a lot differently and a lot better. And so at this point, you've got to start thinking, okay, could Christ have represented us if he was just God in a bod? Or if he just thought through his deified cognition? If he just thought through his deified cognition, the idea And they didn't get quite this deep into it with Apollinarianism. But the idea is that he could not represent me throughout the stages of my life. Maybe he represented me at the cross, but he didn't really overcome sin the same way I have to struggle with it each day, because I have to struggle with it with limited knowledge and only the guidance of the Holy Spirit, which is sometimes I'm not sure what's going to happen.
Even though we haven't articulated it very well yet, the early church recognizes, as this Apollinarianism comes about, that maybe they haven't defined it exactly yet, but they recognize taking away Christ's humanity is all of a sudden going to have some serious ramifications for our soteriology, for our salvation. And so you'll see that this first idea comes forth, and eventually they have to condemn that, recognizing it's problematic. In other words, we need Christ's humanity. Although we haven't fully articulated why and how, we need it, and that's where we're going.
And not only does it have to be recapitulated, not only does he have to live the life that we were supposed to live to be the second Adam and be a true second Adam, he also has to die on the cross and at that cross be fully, as you said, he has to fully represent everything that man is. Now, if he was just God in a bod, what it was represented at the cross? Our body, soul, or spirit? Or body and immaterial? Material or immaterial? Material. How many people here just want their body redeemed? Okay. We want all of us redeemed. In order for all of us to be redeemed, Christ had to become all of us.
No, it wouldn't have been a struggle. He was just pretending to be human. Right? I mean, that's where you'd have to go. If you take this route, if he's really just God, I mean, he's not really struggling. I mean, he can turn off pain sensors, couldn't he? If he wanted to. I mean, he's God. Right? We weaken the story by taking his humanity away, because it was a very real struggle. You make him only God, and you've defeated the struggle that he goes with. You defeat all sorts of teachings of Christ and his reaction to people. It's serious.
As Gregory, again, Apollinarius' opponent, goes on to say, he says, what God has not assumed is not saved. We need all of us to be assumed in order to be saved. So that was quickly rejected